Grace and peace from our Lord Jesus Christ. May the grace of the Lord Jesus Christ be with all of you. We are so delighted to be together this morning on this beautiful, warm summer morning, that we can gather together as a community to worship the living God. I'm especially grateful to have one of my colleagues and friends, one of the ministers of the gospel with us this morning, as our guest preacher, the Reverend Dr. Gabriel Salguero. You will see a little bit about his bio in the bulletin. He is currently pastoring in Orlando, Florida, so he brought the warmth of Florida to North Carolina. But he is also currently the president of the National Latino Evangelical Coalition. So he is a national leader in the church. And we are blessed by his presence this morning and anticipate the word today. Secondly, I want to acknowledge, I know she's already played this summer for one of our services, I believe. She's no stranger to us, but I want to acknowledge our guest harpist this morning, Anita Burroughs Price, who is the principal harpist with the North Carolina Symphony. So it's always a blessing to have her sharing her gifts with us. Last but not least, today after the service, there will be a fellowship with lemonade and perhaps some other snacks outside in front of Page Auditorium under the magnolia trees. So there will be shade. So if you head out through the back, it's on the right-hand side. So please fellowship with one another. This is the day that the Lord has made. Let us rejoice and be glad in it. The Lord is in his holy temple. Let us worship God and sing praise to God who is above. Please stand as we worship God. Thank you.
healing balm, our souls are filled, and every faithless murmur stilled. Let us confess our sins to our Lord, who is never far away. Steadfast Lord, you call your people out of captivity, yet we refuse to return to you. We are blinded by denial, ignorance, pride, and shame, and we tremble in fear of what we have done and that which we have not. Lord, have mercy. Abiding Savior, you are seated with God, our Creator and Sustainer, yet we look for you in earthly things. We set our minds on concerns that separate us from you and from one another. Renew our hearts and our lives with the glory of your saving grace. Christ, have mercy. Merciful God, you fill our lives with abundance, yet in greed and anxiety, we hoard our gifts from you. Increase in us a desire for abundant living, marked by loving kindness, genuine hospitality, and great generosity. Lord, have mercy. Today's scripture assures us Christ is all and in all. In God's mercy, for Christ's sake, and through the Holy Spirit, our sins are forgiven. Thanks be to God. Believing in this good news, let us share signs of Christ's peace with one another.
Please join me in the prayer for illumination printed in your bulletin. God of our pilgrimage, you have willed that the gate of mercy should stand open for those who trust in you. Send your Spirit now to illuminate your holy word. Through Jesus Christ our Lord. Amen. The Old Testament lesson is from Hosea, the 11th chapter. When Israel was a child, I loved him, and out of Egypt I called my son. The more I called them, the more they went from me. They kept sacrificing to the Baals and offering incense to idols. Yet it was I who taught Ephraim to walk. I took them up in my arms, but they did not know that I healed them. I led them with cords of human kindness, with bands of love. I was to them like those who lift infants to their cheeks. I bent down to them and fed them. They shall return to the land of Egypt, and Assyria shall be their king, because they have refused to return to me. The sword rages in their cities. It consumes their oracle priests and devours because of their schemes. My people are bent on turning away from me. To the Most High they call, but he does not raise them up at all. How can I give you up, Ephraim? How can I hand you over, O Israel? How can I make you like Admah? How can I treat you like Zeboim? My heart recoils within me. My compassion grows warm and tender. I will not execute my fierce anger. I will not again destroy Ephraim, for I am God and no mortal, the Holy One in your midst, and I will not come in wrath. They shall go after the Lord who roars like a lion. When he roars, his children shall come trembling from the west. They shall come trembling like birds from Egypt and like doves from the land of Assyria. And I will return them to their homes, says the Lord. This is the word of the Lord. The New Testament lesson is from Colossians, the third chapter. So if you have been raised with Christ, seek the things that are above, where Christ is, seated at the right hand of God. Set your minds on things that are above, not on things that are on earth. For you have died, and your life is hidden with Christ in God. When Christ, who is your life, is revealed, then you also will be revealed with him in glory. Put to death, therefore, whatever in you is earthly: fornication, impurity, passion, evil desire, and greed, which is idolatry. On account of these, the wrath of God is coming on those who are disobedient. These are the ways you also once followed when you were living that life. But now you must get rid of all such thing: anger, wrath, malice, slander, and abusive language from your mouth. Do not lie to one another, seeing that you have stripped off the old self with its practices and have clothed yourselves with the new self, which is being renewed in knowledge according to the image of its creator. In that renewal, there is no longer Greek and Jew, circumcised and uncircumcised, barbarian, Scythian, slave and free, but Christ is all and in all. This is the word of the Lord.
Gospel lesson is from Luke, the 12th chapter. Someone in the crowd said to Jesus, "Teacher, tell my brother to divide the family inheritance with me." But he said to him, "Friend, who set me to be the judge or arbitrator over you?" And he said to him, "Take care. Be on your guard against all kinds of greed, for one's life does not consist in the abundance of possessions." Then he told them a parable. The land of a rich man produced abundantly, and he thought to himself, "What should I do? For I have no place to store my crops." Then he said, "I will do this. I will pull down my barns and build larger ones. And there I will store all my grain
and my goods. And I will say to my soul, soul, you have ample goods laid up for many years. Relax, eat, drink, be merry. But God said to him, you fool, this very night your life is being demanded of you. And the things you have prepared, whose will they be? So it is with those who store up treasures for themselves, but are not rich toward God. This is the word of the Lord.
Thanks be to God.
You may be seated this morning. Someone from the crowd invites the pastor to deal with the will and to solve the inheritance. If you want to have a short tenure as a pastor, get involved in debates over inheritance and wills. Pastor, can you come down to the law office, to the courtroom? Can you help us settle this inheritance issue? Of course, that was the place of the rabbi in that day. He was judge. My brother doesn't want to give me what belongs to me. Jesus was a young rabbi. Perhaps he was born at night, but not last night. And so he gets to the core of the issue. Luke underlines for us that Jesus starts a sermon series based on the question of one of the brothers. A sermon series that is tough to preach, whether you're the local preacher or the visiting Puerto Rican preacher. About finances and family and stewardship and rights. Luke is wrestling over and over, una y otra vez, with the challenges of stewardship, generosity, of greed, of selfishness. The Lucan economy, in the words of Jesus, is a topsy-turvy analysis of what is truly valuable. It's not lost on me that the text is concerning possessions, but is often tied in the Gospel of Luke. Possessions are often tied with questions of family relationships, filial relationships, neighborly relationships, community relationships. Somehow in the Gospel of Luke, when you're talking about money and finances and possessions and wealth, Jesus always ties it back to relationship. So he starts a series here, immediately followed by the prodigal son. Remember what the prodigal son told his father? Give me my inheritance. Or the rich man and Lazarus, and the rich man dies somehow in heaven. The problem is not about him being rich, because you'll notice that in heaven, the rich man has a conversation, and he has it with Abraham. So it's probably a millionaire talking with a multimillionaire. And they're talking about, what do we do with our possessions? How do we steward our relationships and our finances? And then over there in Luke 18, what is often called the pericope of the rich young ruler, he asks in interesting terms about salvation. He says, what must I do to inherit eternal life? And so the question, at least in the Gospel of Luke, is really about how do possessions and wealth and finances tie with our human relationships? How do we deal with what we have in relationship with who we are? I find it interesting. I'm a Jersey Rican. For those of you who don't know what that is, that's a Puerto Rican born in the Jersey Shore. I find it interesting that often in America, when you introduce yourself or are introduced to someone, after they ask you your name, one of the first questions is, what do you do for a living? It's often about career and vocation. But in Puerto Rico, the first question is not usually, what do you do for a living? The first question usually is, ¿quién es tu mamá? Translate it. Who's your mom? In other words, that first introduction has very little to do with socioeconomic status, with education, and has everything to do with who's in your tribe, who's your family, who do you get along with, who do you include, and who do you exclude? ¿Quién es tu mamá? And Jesus recognizes that the problem here is not so much the tension between who gets the larger part of the inheritance and the lesser part. The problem here is that because of greed, they can't see each other. Last week at a pastoral staff meeting, our youth pastor brought to our attention, we have about 10 pastors on staff at Iglesia El Calvario in Orlando, that several days and nights last week, the church parking lot was filled with many people. Not on a service night or not on a night where corporate worship is happening. Filled with people, many of them young people. And when we asked him, why is the parking lot filled? He began, and I'm Pentecostal, he began to speak in an unknown tongue. He said, it's because of Squirtle and Nerodon and Arcanine and Charmander and Pikachu. When he said the last word, I had the gift of interpretation. He said, it's because of Pokemon Go. Our church parking lot is a Pokemon gym or a Pokemon stop. Eric Kane in Forbes magazine has talked about the incredible growth of Pokemon Go. Did you know, I didn't know this, I had to ask my 11-year-old son, what is the catchphrase of Pokemon? You gotta catch them all. You gotta get it all. You gotta capture it all. And Eric Kane in Forbes magazine says that many people see in the dimensions of Pokemon Go, what President Obama once called in one of his books, the insatiable appetite for more. Siempre queremos más. I have 100 Pokemons, I need 300 Pokemons. I have 300 Pokemons, I need 400 Pokemons. I discovered there are about 720 Pokemons. But then he said something very interesting in his analysis of Pokemon Go that I think is what Jesus was trying to say to this brother who tried to bring him into a dispute of which he would have none of. He says that in their search for Pokemon, when they're going to the parks and the parking lots, and yes, I did not know this, that to get an extra life or more life, you have to go either to a church or a synagogue. Interesting. That in their search, they got more exercise, but they also built relationships. And in his article in Forbes magazine, Kane says, he shows a picture of police officers playing Pokemon Go with young African Americans. And I said to myself, perhaps the secret, the mystery, the power, if there is a redeemable gospel message in young people in church parking lots, is that their search for more found them deep relationships, new relationships, boundary crossing relationships. And so Jesus gets to the core of the issue. He's wrestling in the Gospel of Luke. Dr. Luke is wrestling. The writer is wrestling with the tension of how do we navigate abundance when we have a world that thinks in terms of scarcity? How do we navigate relationships when much of the world's messages is we don't have enough? There's not enough to go around. One of the scariest shows on television for me is on one of those TLC channels. You know, those channels, at least in my family, that my wife makes me watch so then I can then buy things at Home Depot or Lowe's. Every time I see that channel, I walk into another room. One of those shows that really draws my attention is Hoarders. Have you ever seen this show? People who have their house filled with things for whatever reasons, and usually in the middle of the show they have an intervention with the family, a psychologist, sometimes they bring in a pastor. And what the show shows most of the time is that this challenge of hoarding, separates the family. The family's disintegrating. They can no longer see each other. That's what Jesus is getting to. I don't know if you know, but almost 50 years ago to the day, Dr. Martin Luther King Jr. preached on this very text. He entitled it, "The Man Whom Jesus Calls a Fool." He diagnosed the problem, and he said the challenge of this man was not that he was rich. Clearly, Jesus was not saying your problem is that you have possessions. Dr. King says that the problem was that the means by which he lived outdistanced the ends for which he lived. That things were more important than relationships. That the second problem of this dysfunction was that he failed to realize his dependence on other people. In that short message of the gospel in Luke, even though there are less than 60 words, he says the word I and my more than 15 times. He failed to realize that no matter how much he had a surplus of possessions, but a deficit of love and empathy and solidarity. And secondly, he failed to realize that although there were a lot of things that he can control, there were things he could not control. His utter dependence on God. Somehow, this brother needed to hear the message of a man who had surplus in abundance of possessions, but deficit in emotional empathy, deficit in relational ties, deficit in the capacity to love. One of my favorite prophetess, you might know her, it's prophetess Tina Turner. You remember Tina's song? Oh, what's love got to do, got to do, got to do with it? Oh, what's love but a secondhand emotion? I was like, Tina, love's got everything to do with it. For perhaps it is not money or mammon or friends or networks or social networks that makes the world go round. Perhaps it is possible to have a surplus of possessions and be called a fool. Perhaps this is the paradox of our existence in our generation, that we have stuff, but we can't see people. Perhaps we are hoarders in our own soul, and we are seduced by the concept of scarcity in an age of abundance. We run from God to things, as happened in the book of Hosea, because someone has convinced us that God is not enough, that love is not enough, that faith is not enough. And so selfishness, greed, which is idolatry, Jesus says, are the consequences of a soul deficit, of an unsatisfied soul. The economic ledger, sisters and brothers, the economic ledger, el presupuesto económico nunca está separado del presupuesto espiritual. El presupuesto económico nunca está separado del presupuesto espiritual. The economic ledger, sisters and brothers, is never separated from the spiritual ledger. Adam Smith, in his thesis on economy, talked to us about the wealth of nations and an invisible hand. But the gospel tells us that perhaps it is not the invisible hand of supply and demand that can be the only thing that drives our economies and our relationships. Perhaps Jesus, in this series of sermons where he's dragged into a sibling rivalry about inheritance, where a rich man is talking about inheritance while not being able to surrender, perhaps there's another invisible hand that has nothing to do with supply and demand, but has to do with solidarity, compassion, love, surrender. Let me be clear, when Jesus is talking and he's trying to resolve this, he's wrestling with the questions of our generation and every generation. He's wrestling with that paradox of how am I a steward of what God has given me? How do I deal with surplus and abundance? Do I build bigger warehouses? Do I stock up more things? How am I a steward of generosity without sinking into greed? He's wrestling with the question Sigmund Freud preguntó en su libro La Civilización y sus Descontentos, Civilization and its Discontents. Freud says, it is impossible to escape the impression that people commonly use false standards of measurement, that we seek power, success, and wealth for ourselves and admire that in others, but that we underestimate what is of true value in life. It is possible to have a surplus and have an emotional and spiritual deficit. Jesus asked the question, de qué le vale? That Spanish translates, of what value is it? In English, we use the economic term, what profited a person to gain the world and in the end lose his or her soul? Shakespeare, I think, read the text in his sonnet 146 when he begins to write something that penetrates la psique humana. I think he was talking specifically to what Dr. King said when he writes, why so large a cost having so short a lease? Dost thou upon thy fading mansion spend? Within be fed, without be rich no more. Let me be clear this morning, hermanos y hermanas. The tension between stewardship and greed is a thin one. The discernment that we need between searching for Pokemons in a church parking lot and somehow through God's providence, finding new friends and building new relationships. Tina is asking us, what's love got to do with it? Everything. Absolutely everything. Dr. King finishes his sermon almost 50 years ago on this text when he says, exactly why did Jesus call this man a fool? Perhaps he, like me often, was seduced by affluence while ignoring relationships. Surplus of acknowledgement, of influence, and deficit of relationships. The other day I went to a young adults meeting at my church. There were about 70 or 80 young adults between the ages of 18 and 35. And all of a sudden I noticed that nobody was talking. And there were two people looking down onto their iPhone. And when I looked in their iPhone, I said, can I see? I said, what are you doing? He says, I'm talking, I'll use this name. I'm talking to Jane. I said, where is she? She said, right next to me. Could it be that we heed riches more than relationships? Could it be that we are seduced by the power of things instead of being stewards of things? Could it be that much of the tensions of American race relations and economic relations is not because people have and people don't have. It's because in our having, we lose sight of others. Podrá ser what Paul or the writer of the book of Colossians said is, we're looking in the wrong direction. You're searching for Pikachu. You're searching for your Pokemon. And you're missing your sister or your brother. Could it be? But there's hope, sisters and brothers. If the diagnosis of our moral economy is that we have a soul deficit, that we suffer from an insatiable appetite for more, there is hope in the gospel of Jesus Christ when Paul says, when Christ, who is our life, appears. when finally we see what matters most, Christ in all, for all. That pericope in Colossians ends with this phrase saying, if you're able to put everything in its proper perspective, if in your surplus you're able to steward into generosity, if in your affluence and influence you're able to share, it says, when that happens, there is no longer Greek nor Jew. When that happens, these dividing walls that the hoarding of our lives impede us from seeing each other, when Christ, who is our life, appears, then, the writer says, we too will appear in our purest selves. Hermanos y hermanas, muchos de nosotros corremos. Many of us run. And that running is because we're thirsty. We're hungry. Tenemos hambre y tenemos sed. We want more. Give me my inheritance now. And sometimes at the cost of relationships. But there is a water that satiates the human soul. There is a bread that satisfies the human hunger. There is a Christ who tells us, your soul need not hunger and thirst anymore. And no matter what you have or what you don't have, hermanos y hermanas, God is more than enough. God is more than enough. The word of the Lord for the people of the Lord. Thanks be to the Lord.
The Lord be with you. Let us pray. Search us, O God, and know our hearts. And as you search our hearts, may we search not for Pokemon, but may we search for you. And in our seeking, may we find you even as we pray. In the current state of this world, as a living cesspool of violence, hatred, anger, wrath, slander, abusive language, greed, division, anxiety, and fear, we breathe in your renewing spirit of life as we yearn for hope, peace, love, and justice. We acknowledge that you haven't given us a spirit of fear, but call us to bold, courageous living in Christ. We are so bold to name the pain of the world and in our lives. We are so bold to name on our hearts this morning those deficits that we live out. And we believe that you hear and answer our prayers. And so we tug at your compassionate heart and say, Lord, in your mercy, hear our prayer. As the world struggles and groans with agony, we know that the church does too, groaning over its lost place of influence and privilege in society, groaning over years of splits and divisions, groaning over how to really live out the mission of God in today's society, groaning because we know that often we go after religion or riches rather than a relationship with you. Groaning because of internal church conflicts over beliefs and behaviors. We ask, O God, that the Spirit of Christ would not only unify the church in visible ways, but cause us to be viable, effective witnesses to the love of Christ, rather than acting as if Jesus is nowhere to be found. Set our minds on things above, so that we may understand how to live faithful lives here below on earth. Lord, help us to be Christians in our hearts, that our lives may be light and salt, storing treasures not for ourselves, but toward your kingdom. Lord, in your mercy, hear our prayer. As a body of Christ, we recognize that we are broken spiritually, psychologically, emotionally, and physically. Some of us are hurting with wounds that seem to never heal. We remember the broken body today, those fractured from bad relationships or physical ailments. But we also remember that you are acquainted with our grief and sorrow and suffering, and that through your brokenness, we believe that we are healed. Give us patience in waiting, perseverance in hoping, and the courage to keep on living until the day you call us and gather us to your eternal home. You are our ultimate home and present hope. We offer these prayers and our lives to you as living sacrifices. May they rise to you and be a sweet-smelling aroma for your glory. In the name of Jesus Christ, our Lord and Savior. Amen. Today's offering and tithes will go toward supporting undergraduate students who desire to take spring break mission trips. Please give to God cheerfully and joyfully.
Abundant Lord, your love is never ending and your mercy never fails. We celebrate your works among us and we give thanks that in you, Christ, you have saved us from the deeds of death and opened for us the ways of eternal life. In unswerving faithfulness, you give good gifts of the Holy Spirit to all, and in your persistent grace, you grant all that we need. With grateful hearts, we acknowledge the many riches you bestow, and we glorify your name today and every day. Take the gifts offered here and use them to strengthen our students who venture beyond these walls on mission trips. May we share your love abundantly through work in your world and reflection on your word. And may all people enjoy the myriad ways you enrich us through creation, community, and Christ Jesus. God of many faces, we celebrate the ways in which you call us into deep relationships with diverse neighbors. Empower us to serve you in boundary-crossing ways, that our lives may reflect the honor we give you. Make us bold in asking, thankful in receiving, tireless in seeking, and joyful in finding, that we may always proclaim your kingdom coming and do your will on earth as we pray. Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not to temptation, but deliver us from evil. Thine is the kingdom and the power and the glory forever and ever. In Christ, there is no east or west. In him, no south or north. May we now go forth in every direction to proclaim the good news of God's love. And may God the Father, Son, and Holy Spirit go with us and guide us today and every day. Amen.